What up, the ladies and gentlemen? It's your boy Eazy, and we are live from the
My Bookie Studios. That's right, we did it. I'm finally here.
It's Eazy. Speak Eazy, baby.
So this was super spur of the moment. I'm a man, Stick. We were talking Friday, and he offered up the studio for me Monday, and I'd be a fucking fool not to take advantage of that. So I appreciate this, Stick, and Woodward Sports and My Bookie for being the dope ass dude and fucking 4-time Stanley Cup champion, D-Mac. What up, though, man?
Yeah.
All good, Eazy, all good. You been a busy boy, and yes. Happy to be part of the same team, not only Woodward Sports, but obviously with stuff we got going on with the Hook that yes. You can catch 3 to 5 every Monday to Friday. So you've been learning new craft, and how's it? Let me ask you a little quick, Eazy, so people that know that if you haven't seen old Eazy at all, it's because we've been burying them at the My Bookie Studios. Keeping them in there, running the ones and twos, working on the cameras, working on loading up all the clips, and a little bit different perspective than sitting on the other side of the microphone.
Oh my God, so different, man. It's so different. That's why, I mean, honestly, I want to be here to showcase myself a little bit too, so I get out of there a little bit too eventually too, because I want to get, it is a lot in there, man. It is a lot. Like, loading this shit up and just like scrolling through, being prepared, it's a lot. It's a big task at hand, but I'm appreciative to grow with the fam, with Sports Network, because I'm glad of what we got here, man. We got something big, I feel like, honestly.
No, but we do, and if anybody wants to look, first thing you got to go back is what Woodward Sports is all about, and that's being out and about in the D with the people. It's a people station. We had opening day downtown at the pizza bar there,
Brass Rail
Pizza Bar. Phenomenal.
On your birthday, by the way.
On my birthday. Yeah. I got to spend opening day doing a show in the D. Got a chocolate cake from all the fellas. Everybody sing me happy birthday. It's pretty good to be D-Mac. And then, you know, I end up going to
Tell me you did that.
Well, my night ended up in the Blue Room. And if anybody knows the Blue Room, that's Trick's studio. And got to preview a new movie that's coming out at the end of the month that he written, directed, called The Last 24. And I don't know if I enjoyed it more because of the product placement and because of the cast, that I know most of the cats. It was really entertaining. And if you're from Detroit, you're going to want to see The Last 24. So, you know, what can I say? He's a huge influence for me. We all, you know, as different people in your lifetime where you be able to have respect, and him and I are both the same age, but what he's done, not only in
Godfather of the City of Detroit,
Detroit, and how he cares about the people and what he's really about.
Yeah.
And it's just, he's one of the people that I look up to, and I'm just grateful to call him a friend. So between him and Mikey Hsu and Adam and E-Rock and everybody, we had a great time.
So this is pre-recorded for you guys, if you're watching this like live in the premiere or whatever, but is it cool if I put you guys a little picture in there?
For sure.
You got to
show off the D-Mac 25 wax joint that we smoked. You asked me, yeah, we smoked a few of those. So
I think it was huge. Donald Trump, huge.
That's how we roll.
Yeah. One of the reasons I wanted to hit you up to you know, do this with me on Monday, my first time in the studio, was we actually started a podcast in my basement. Well, your garage, my basement, virtually, and the internet kind of shit on us. But I asked you a question. I still haven't got the answer to it. I want to know this.
All right.
Because D-Mac's really big into wrestling, if you guys don't know.
I love wrestling. It's my favorite sport. Why? Because I'm never disappointed. Why? Because it's not real. It's scripted. And these guys are phenomenal, and I know a lot of them. And, you know, for me, it's, you know, there's two things, right? There's WWE, which is corporation, Vince McMahon, dictatorship. That's entertainment, right? Because you shake your head, and if you're talking that, what they did with the Hurt Business, but that's a Vince thing. He's going to ruin your dreams or what you think is best for that. Now, on the
wait, what happened with the Hurt Business? Because I don't watch it routinely, but I was keeping an eye on them because, like, they're pretty sweet. They're like, they're old school. I knew who Bobby Lashley was, Shelton Benjamin.
Dude, Bobby Lashley could probably rip 99.9% of people's heads off their bodies.
He actually did MMA, too.
Did he really?
Yeah, and MVP. purple belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Yeah, I knew, I knew that. And like a lot of those guys have different disciplines. But so what happened was Bobby Lashley, who, if you look it up, look up the Hurt Business, you can flash some pictures or whatever, and Cedric Alexander and Shelton Benjamin. And so it and led by MVP. So it was one of the factions, and the fact that it, you know, it was all black and it was menacing, but they dressed really nice and they were all business and they were like, they were like ballers, right? And they took no crap, and they, you know, they stuck up. And Bobby Lashley, who is going to be fighting Drew McIntyre at WrestleMania, but then they decided, you know, to that Lashley was mad at him, and they had him turn on him the other day. Oh, and so now
that was,
it's just
that's a quick turn, bro. They just started.
Dude, that's, I know. I'm hoping that it leads to something bigger, but I don't see. Here's the thing: I don't invest in it. It's because it's WWE.
Well, Vince, you know, like
Vince has made me that way because it's a corporation, right? Whereas opposed to AEW and the Forbidden Door, the Impacts, the New Japans, the NWAs, all these other ones, what you have, right? Where Vince McMahon was the dictator of, because he had all the money. Now you have Tony Khan. Tony Khan, who they own.
That's AEW?
That's AEW. They own the Jacksonville Jaguars. They own.
It's that guy with the
stash?
They own the
Premier League football, the soccer team. Like, they're billionaires on over, right? Now the son, right, who is probably, I don't know, 35, 40 or whatever, is a diehard wrestling fan and always has been. Mm-hmm. So a few years ago when they put together, he saw the Chris Jericho, Kenny Omega match, because it's just like society. We're as guys get older, like myself and you know, Jericho and I are the same age, and watch him, a buddy of mine, watch him his whole career and stuff, and watch how he transformed. But it's about the AEW and all these other factions. Now they're cross promoting, and now they're helping each other out. And
that's
what you
dope.
Feel, what you feel.
Vince too.
What's that?
Vince too, or everyone outside
WWE? Vince. So now here's So WWE, and then everybody outside of it is cross promoting.
Oh, so they're like, fuck you. Like,
they're just like you're together. The dictatorship.
Yeah.
We're so Kenny Omega is fighting Rich Swann, who's the champion Impact, and
that's
he's a champion AEW.
It's like SmackDown versus Raw outside of, you know what I'm saying?
It is, and here's the difference, because they say, well, they used to do that because they used to have...
Or Nitro. Nitro versus
Raw.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, but it used to have factions and stuff like this, and they used to have territories. That's what they used to call it, right? They used to call it territories. But what would happen is that they, you know, you'd have your promoter from each territory. You'd want your champ win because
or
that helped.
Pay up to even get him on your show.
So now it's more so where it's the same thing as in WWE. It's scripted. Right, where they have to read off lines or remember lines or whatever. Yeah. AEW, it's a concept, and they do it. If you want to learn into more of the culture and what it is, there's two great vlogs or YouTube shows that I watch. Being the Elite, which is, it'll show you the Jacksons and Kenny Omega and Hangman Adam Page and all these guys, how sort of the evolution, because they've been blogging this. They got 300 and some episodes, and then Sammy Guevara's blog. So then guys are all coming out. So you get to, you know, like Miro, right? Who's Rusev, used to be
real
in
quick,
WWE. Yeah.
I was going to ask, if you want to answer this one too, because we were talking about factions. Who's the greatest faction? What's your favorite faction?
Degeneration X.
Degeneration. Okay, I expect that one. Do you have one for WWE? Like, you know,
I was
the groups,
a big
like NWO.
I was a big Road Dogg guy.
I stopped following wrestling probably like 15 years ago. Like, I'm like old school Marty Jannetty Rockers. I'm British Bulldog. I'm Hulk Hogan. I'm Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah,
like that's
Midnight
when
Express.
I was
what about like
wrestling.
The teams though? Like, you know, like the Hardy Boys are doing all the crazy shit on the ladders. Like, what, like tag teams or like groups?
Demolition, baby. Demolition.
Dude,
that's
hey,
before my time. I don't
know
who they are.
Time out.
Can you put them on the screen?
You don't know who they are?
Yeah, we Google and put one on the screen.
Listen,
I might know them.
Listen.
Hawk and Animal?
No, that was Legion. That was
that's
the
Legion.
Road
they
Warriors.
Were the, yeah.
Those
oh,
are the
no,
Road Warriors. Axe and Smash. Listen,
they wore the
I'll
pads?
Tell you. No, they wore.
How deep did we just get into wrestling?
The
now?
Metal,
so
right? There was a Legion of Doom, and then there was Demolition. And in junior, where I played in Belleville, our centerman's name was Jake, so he was Jake the Snake, and Axe, Craig Frazier was Axe, and I was Smash on the right side. We were Demolition. We had signs and everything like
that's
that.
That's awesome.
So they were my favorite tag team, but like, you know, now it's sort of like, if you watch, you talk about factions, you watch AEW, that's all it is. You watch the way that the storytelling's gone, and if you watch, I'm part of a Wrestling Perspective podcast, right?
Yes.
Myself, Petey Williams, who's a two-time TNA champ, Lars
and where could people check that out at?
wrestling perspective pod.
You ready, Easy?
It's on, yes, it's on Fight TV. Yeah. Yeah, that's me on
those
the right.
Those guys. Yeah, that looks like my man who's always at the Lions game.
That's
super
me.
Fan, Lions super fan. That's,
yeah, and the Hangman in the end zone. Yeah, no, those were, that's Axe and Smash. Nice job, Stick.
So the reason why I wanted to ask, the whole reason why wrestling, we went down a fucking rabbit hole. But I wanted to ask, because you love it so much, if you were to wrestle, that's why I asked you before the internet fucked us up.
Oh.
What would D-Mac's wrestling name be? What would the character, you know what I'm saying? Like, give me this.
Type of character? It would be more of a...
heel? Good guy?
No, it'd be like... So, it'd be more like a... have an edge. You know, so edge... It'd be the mentality of Stone Cold. But it'd be like the
rock and roll of edge.
R-rated. Yeah, just sort of like that, but could go sort of both ways. Has the nicer Seth Rollins... You know what I mean? Like, not the vindictive or whiny, but, like, be able to control the mic, but also, too, is, like, bad at... You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, what do you call that? This is not a baby face, right? Where you're that, right? Or are you still, you know what, you're still,
you know,
a good guy?
Yeah, you know, like, could go either way, where it's, like, the sort of the tweener, you're not really the heel, but you
know...
What's
this guy's name?
So if I would...
Just D-Mac? He's just going as D-Mac?
Nah, I don't know. I don't...
You never thought about this?
No, I never did, dude. No, I've never thought about what my wrestling name...
I'm man. I'm mind blown because you've done everything that you love.
You know
you've done the music.
You know
you've done
what's
comedy,
messed up?
Four fucking championships.
Easy. I never, ever... you know what? I think it was because I was so beat down. My body when I was done playing, coming off three surgeries or whatever. But just trying to get... And being where I was, like, in such a bad place and in my addiction and stuff, that it never crossed my mind.
Yeah.
Right? Like, the band crossed my mind. The comedy crossed my mind. The wrestling, because of the physical. Now, I always say, my goal is to get the microphone or to be involved. You know, you got the Bad Bunnies and stuff. I don't know. You know,
that's what I'm saying. That's what I want to see.
I saw Shaq get friggin' powerbombed through a table, and I was like, bucket list. I want to get powerbombed. And so Tommy Dreamer in Impact, who's the ultimate ECW hardcore guy, he promised me that he would make that happen.
I got a name for you, D-Mac.
Got it.
Darren the Turtle Hunter McCarty.
Turtle Hunter.
It's too long. What would Stick's wrestling name be?
I just go by Stick.
Stick.
Stick Bayless.
Stick Bayless.
Stick Bayless. Just
I came
just
up with that.
Stern.
I was like, I don't know why I had to know that I came up with that, though.
You did.
Hey, it's good, though. It sticks. Ha, ha, ha.
Well, there's different. You got to understand. See, Stick's more of a, like, a Mankind. He can be Dude Love. He can be Cactus Jack. He can be Mankind. Three in one, right? So Skip Bayless is the pot stirring, you know, Stick.
Yes, that's why. Then it was nothing like your takes. It was like he's stirring the pot.
Dude, they just call him the Irish. Just call him Irish.
The Irish. That's, dude, I like that.
The Irish
tilt, because he's tall. Yeah. The Irish tilt. Not, what do they call it? Skilt? Or was it skirt?
Oh, kilt.
Yeah, but the Irish tilt, because Stick's tall.
Yeah.
The Irish tilt.
Irish tilt. There we go. Or
what
whatever.
Do they call those big logs that they throw?
Cabers.
Penises.
Yeah, the I'm big caber.
Caber. How about
Irish caber.
Irish caber.
Irish caber. Oh, listen, geez. I'm going to hit up Nick Leach. I'm going to get us some graphics, bro. He's got to make us
some
wrestling.
Oh, yeah. We
got
to make us all wrestling guys and stuff like that to be what it was. But that's why in any adventure, any venture, right? In sports, athletics, any celebrity movies, wrestling, whatever, it's longevity, right? And guys that have been there and been through and transformed. That's why I like the utmost respect for a guy like Chris Jericho, who's been around the business 30 years and transformed himself.
It's like a Vince McMahon type role. That's crazy. It's awesome.
Which a different thing. So getting back to it is I love, you know, and maybe that's just... Where you ask that is why I was always such a big fan. And I think that because I got out of it, I wasn't into wrestling when I retired.
Yeah.
If I would have been, it probably might have led me to think I could do something.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm fairly athletic, but then it means you got to work out and you got to do all that stuff. And I'm not Chris Draper. Chris Draper sent him in the grind line. He gets sick if he doesn't work out. D-Mac, opposite. I'll get sick if I work out.
You still got it, though, man. I'm walking down the hallway. I'll give D-Mac a fist pump, and it's just like I was not expecting like a bomb to come there on that one. But.
They're heavy. Like, I didn't say that I was out of shape. Chad thinks I can't go more than a minute.
Bro, you can go more than a minute. Trust me. Like you're deceiving. Yeah. 100% deceiving.
Dude, the guys like me, we're Canadian. We're farm boy strong, right? Yeah. So, Gordie Howe, Bob Probert, who never, if you look at Bob Probert's shirt off, you'd be like, that's the heavyweight champion of the world. He's got no shoulders, stuff like that. At least I'm broad. I used to have some size, but atrophy set in.
We still like,
it's wiry, yeah. Right? It's that strength.
It's like
stick strength. Stick has that wiry because it must be the Irish in us or something that it's like, that it works differently. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I always try to tell people, it's like, I'm not strong. I don't have big muscles, but my ligaments are very strong for some reason.
No, that's a thing.
Big bones too.
That's a thing.
They used to call me Bam Bam. I don't know my own strength because I break. Well, I'm the odds-on favorite -1200 to break a fucking door around here because they're all glass. They agreed. All open up.
I thought it was gonna happen today for a minute there. I mean, no, that's 100% true though. What Stick was saying, because you look at a guy like Kevin Durant, you look so wiry and skinny, but he's backing guys down in the NBA in the post and hitting shots over him. You're like, there's no way, but it's a thing. You know what I'm saying?
No, there's that athleticism, and then there's different guys that, and in different sports too, you got to find out, because here's the big difference, right? If you're saying hockey, the big difference in every sport is now the training, the preparation at a younger age, all that stuff. But it's, you learn things along the way.
Yeah.
Right? You learn things about along the way. So a lot of the stuff, like when we did, like growing up and working out, yeah, there was like plyometrics, but you didn't understand about the core.
Yeah.
Right? So skating about your core. I've had three sport hernia surgeries, two that I ripped through the walls and one I ripped off the bone.
God damn.
Which is nowadays the core workout, all that different stuff, plyometrics. Well, it would have strengthened it up, but you don't see it's, even though you're playing a sport, is sometimes that you're not prepared right or whatever like that. So the fact that when the uber talented, you know, they know that being wiry or being able to make that move, the twitch factor's quicker than it is to push a guy off, right?
Yeah.
So it all depends. And that's, you know, my strength isn't, I get beat up by a barbell. If you ever see a barbell score a goal? No, but I will absolutely manhandle you to death.
That's a heavyweight champion of the UFC, Francis Ngannou. Not a big weight guy, but a fucking monster.
Monster.
Clearly, right?
And look at that guy. Like, you look at him and go, wow.
Yeah, I'm good.
No, it's just like, man. Like, I've fought guys like that before, just going.
You have?
Oh, yeah. George LaRock was the heavyweight champion, big black guy. And
How'd it end? How'd it go?
Yeah, I did. I'm alive.
That's true. That's I am a company guy. Before we get too far from wrestling, you have I'm a company guy. We have a goal here at Woodward Sports. We want to hit 10K on Instagram. Is it right?
On everything, baby.
So I proposed a DMAC on your birthday. I don't know if you remember, but if we do that, if we hit 10K within the month of April, or maybe we can switch up next month. But you have a buddy at a wrestling school. Do you want to learn how to hit me with a steel chair? I would totally take a chair. If we could hit 10K in the month of April, I'll let D-Mac hit me with a fucking chair.
I will tell you this right now on the Speakeasy podcast hosted in the MyBookie studios, mybookie.ag, by the way, if you want to get there, put the Woodward Sport in for a 50% bonus on your first deposit. Anyways, if you want to...
Company men, that's us.
10,000. We hit 10,000, and we will celebrate with a wrestling shenanigan celebration with a bunch of us. We'll have our own little. I'll get my buddy Jay, and we'll put together a little wrestling shindig.
Because you guys go on field trips, you get the Coney dogs and stuff like that. It's like I want to go to a wrestling school. That's what you're into, and I when I was younger, I was into it. People take chairs. I want to see if it actually hurts, but we got to hit that 10K first, man. That's the goal.
That stuff hurts, man. Like, people think that those guys, it's all fake, but it's scripted. But they're like the best stuntmen on the planet.
Oh my God.
That's it. Hurt unbelievably.
Yeah, when I was little, I was chubbier, so I got picked on too, but I also loved wrestling when I was a kid. Another thing I get in fights over, other than like, you know, good weight jokes, is when people tell me wrestling is fake, I'm like, bro, you jump from a fucking ladder and tell me, like, fake that. You know what I'm saying? Fake jumping from a goddamn ladder into like a table. You know what I'm saying? You can't fake too much of that.
Stick, you nailed it.
You know what I'm saying?
They're some of the greatest, and I'm not going to take away from there might be greater stuntmen doing movies, but they're the greatest stuntmen athletes. That's the whole thing. For me, the biggest fandom that I have is the storylines. So I don't care if I like it or not, as long as it makes sense to me. That's why I love the AEW and even the Impact, because their storylines make sense. And they'll bring, and this is why you know the wrestlers are in charge, because they bring things that happened 7 years ago in Japan between different guys and stuff like that into play, where you can go back and go, wow, look at the full circle that they went with that. And now the way that they've separated the different factions, and literally there's like eight factions in AEW. And one thing I'll tell you, check these guys out. Death Triangle, right? Penta, Rey Fénix Jr., Pentagon Zero Miedo, and the Bastard Pac. They're because AEW's about three trios too. They're some of the greatest luchadors, like Flips and this Rey Fénix, what he does. Penta's one of my favorite. He's got paint. He's painted black and white, and he's got a mask, a lucha mask. And Pac does this triple flip twist off the top rope.
That's another thing, too, they don't get recognized for is the flips and shit, too, like on the jumps. But I wanted to wrestling because I wanted to know what your name would be. But there's a, because I talk a lot of football on my podcast. We got a lot of Lions fans.
Yeah.
A big trade. It didn't happen in our division, but I'm curious why this didn't happen in our division. Sam Darnold to the Panthers. What the fuck are the Bears doing?
Well, they already got Dalton.
But, like, Dalton over Darnold? Like, what are you, like...
What are you doing? The Bears are in our division. Shut the fuck up, Easy.
I know,
what are you
but,
fucking,
like,
dude?
Did that not blow anybody else's mind, though? Were you like, what? Like, because he got
Ryan
traded for
Pace,
shit.
Ryan Pace is, like, legitimately one of our best free agents, even though he's a GM for the Chicago Bears.
Yeah.
Leave him alone. Dude... You know what? Here's the one thing, too, and God bless it. Uh-huh. I'm happy Sam Darnold. See, I'm a Sam Darnold. I just think that he just got screwed by the situation. From what I understand, good kid, hardworking, but he's one of these, you know, when you legitimately come out and tell people that you see ghosts on the field, that you're mentally shot, right? So the fact that they've, you know, with this trade, they've solidified the fact that Zach Wilson's going to the Jets, right? And also for Darnold to go to Carolina and battle with Teddy Bridgewater, whatever. I see this as the best scenario maybe for him to, if he's going to have an NFL career, like a guy that we could say. He's getting the second chance in a little different way, but a lot of the same way as what Jared Goff coming here, even though he's got the contract and everything else. But he's got an opportunity to prove yourself. Yeah. And I know from a fact, you know, like for me being a casualty of the salary cap back in 2004 when we had the lockout year and I end up in Calgary. Yeah, I remember I scored on Manny Legacy in Calgary against the Wings. Man, I was so happy. You want to give it to your old team.
Little D-Generation X.
Yo, in the corner, for sure, bro. Suck it.
The thing that you got to watch out for with Darnold is we kind of went through this with Tannehill.
Yeah.
Under Adam Gase, Tannehill looked like he was the worst quarterback in the league. What happens? He goes to Tennessee,
great point.
Top four quarterback. Sam Darnold under Adam Gase, one of the worst quarterbacks in the league. Now that he has a chance in Carolina, you give him Christian McCaffrey coming out of the backfield.
He's already got rapport with Robbie Anderson, too.
DJ Moore.
Rapport with Robbie Anderson, too, because he was with the Jets before, you know, Panthers.
And then that'll be that's always interesting to me to see, too, is like, you know, we see it here in Detroit of all the, either the New Orleans guys come over, the Rams guys come over with this new regime. It's interesting to hear if Robbie Anderson had what he had to say, if they asked him
because
they do. But here's the stick. That's a great comparison. Ryan Tannehill and Sam Darnold.
I was going to make the Stafford, but that's even better because Adam Gase is involved in both those situations.
To me, that's the common denominator is Adam Gase, and anybody who's played for Gase, like, I've heard he's a great human being, good man, shit coach. Like, he was an awful offensive coordinator in Chicago. Then he was an awful head coach in Miami. Yeah. Then he got an awful great job in New York.
So like, how much money has he made being awful?
Yeah, well, because who...
I love people that fall up.
Yeah. He's that. Who made it? Was he with the Broncos when they won or some shit? Like, why? He was offensive coordinator, if I'm not mistaken. That's why he's big? Because he's been shit ever since.
I think he's been living off Peyton Manning thing for a while. Or the defense, sorry, Von Miller.
Yeah, exactly. It's The Bears are fucking up for missing that one. Do you guys think he's going to start over?
No, they didn't.
Over?
We're Lions fans, Easy, you I know, fucking tool
I know.
Bag.
I know, but it just blows my mind, bro. I'm like, what are you doing?
Well, or other teams or whatever else. So.
And Easy, you nailed it. As the offensive coordinator of the Denver Broncos under John Fox, Gase contributed to Peyton Manning's record-breaking passing season in 2013. Gase and the Broncos also appeared in the Super Bowl, but fell to the Seattle Seahawks 43-8 in a blowout loss. So he was a part of that record-breaking passing season, but it's Peyton Manning.
Yeah, Peyton fucking, he's the offensive coordinator.
We heard that from Joik.
Yeah. So you think he's going to start for sure over Teddy Bridgewater, or you think it's going to be an actual competition?
No, I think it's a healthy competition, but that's okay if he doesn't, because it's working towards something. And, you know, from my experience and just listening to Teddy Bridgewater, being around Drew Brees, being in there, about, you know, team guys too. So you could also be pushed, because I think that he could beat Teddy Bridgewater. He's better. I think he's a better quarterback than Teddy Bridgewater.
Yeah.
You know, so it's something that he gets in a good situation where he's appreciated.
Yeah.
You know, and so they had to move him. I was thinking that they would have to move him, because if they're really set on drafting Zach Wilson, Sam Darnold's like having a rookie there too. He can't, you know, play behind him. He's having two rookies. So
we got to get some value out of him too. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, you're losing for nothing.
Right. Yeah. So you know, you look at it, sixth round this year, second and fourth next year. But, again, they're pieces. And in this day and age, it's, you know, when I immediately think, well, that's a Brad Holmes thing late in the draft, just because that's a late in the draft. So
yeah, it does affect us in the draft a little bit, too. Because,
and it's Chicago, so they'll screw it up.
Yeah. It affects us in the draft, too, because that was, like, one of the teams that were rumored to be a trade partner, was the Panthers trade up from us to grab one of those quarterbacks or whatever.
Right, but so again, I like it, because the more that teams sort of play their hand out, the more that I can nail down what we're going to do. Like, I suspect right now they probably have an understanding about if they are going to choose what they have to do.
Yeah.
Right? More so as far as, I don't know what they're going to, but I trust the fact that these guys are choosing. Dan Campbell, Alpha Positive, Brad Holmes.
Yeah.
You know, Spielman's in there, John Dorsey, all these guys, you know. Yeah. So and we have never, ever had that. Like last year, it's like,
we all knew.
But even last year, so you have the third overall pick, and we've had the first when we got Stafford, but the third overall pick, and 90% of all of our Lions dumb knew they would fuck it up.
Yeah.
And they fucked it up.
Yes. Yeah.
Before the draft by signing Chase Daniel.
They did that, and then they did the Darius Slay trade beforehand too. It's like, bro, you exposed our hand. Like, what are you doing? Like, I see competence in this front office just based off the fact that we don't know who the fuck we're gonna draft. And that's a good sign for me. It's a good enough sign for me that this is we're headed the right direction.
Cards are held tight. And if I was a betting man, I think we trade down.
Oh, for sure. I think it came out today. Bleacher Report actually I got a notification from them that the Falcons and us are both looking to trade down. Now, whether or not the Panthers thing affects us, I don't know. But obviously, if it's out there, then
you would think that, you know, my thing is that if it doesn't go with the first four quarterbacks going in order, that if Lance or Jones slides, that hopefully the Patriots or Denver or somebody comes knocking.
Denver for sure.
You know, so comes knocking. So, but again, you have these options, and they know they have these options, and whatever they do, they're going to weigh them.
Yeah. Where are we at on time, Stick?
About 30 minutes.
All right, bet. Sweet. Well, we'll probably wrap that one up. I definitely do it again. Time. Are you doing that next week, or what's going on with that?
Yeah, we're gonna start. You know what? See, here's the thing, right? If I'm gonna give you the advice, right, of what I do, then I'm gonna have to listen to my own advice.
Oh, I put you on the spot. I'm so sorry.
No, you didn't. Yeah. You didn't, because it also, as far as a set time, and that's the one thing, is that we shot a few episodes of Grind Time.
Yeah,
I believe that next week I have to talk to the man Stick and stuff like this, but we'll try
to Irish. What was it? You got to talk to the Irish
Cable.
Irish cable. There we go. He's got all the plugs.
And man, when I said that to Eazy, I wasn't even thinking about grind time with you. No, no, so I but hope you weren't like thinking I was sending subliminals.
Oh, that's that was all me.
See how great he is on the job? No, no, he was just subliminal.
I was trying to help promote what you got
going
on.
But it's the same thing that I'm going to do. So the same thing that, and to let everybody know, because the transparency, it's like to find one day when we'll be able to do it. Now it's easier to do it with Stick after the show, whatever, like this, yeah. Which is I'm planning on doing it either on a Wednesday or Thursday or whatever it happens, but to consistently do it because I'd like to be able to fire it out live,
yeah,
for whoever's watching, and then take it. I'm going to edit it, put in some bells and whistles. And I always like, see, for me, I love Talk is Jericho. I love Chris Jericho, everything he does.
Yeah.
But I love the way, if you've heard his podcast, the way that he will introduce, like he's already done the interview,
yeah,
then he can go back and introduce the interview, what they talked about, sort of give you a heads up,
yeah,
and it gives you more options, and it's just sort of, there's no right and wrong, it's just whatever you feel.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always learning. Look at the stuff we're doing every day and the stuff you're, yeah, learning, and it's going to be able to apply it so that, you know, everything's rocking and rolling. So sooner than later, the most important thing is to get to that 10,000 so I can smack you with a chair.
Oh my God. So that's why I set, because also, yeah, we want to hit 10,000, but I set the bar so high to hit within the month of April because I still am a little bit worried about getting smacked with a chair, and Stick confirming that it hurts doesn't help that at all.
Well, I don't know, Stick, between, in your experience, getting hit with pretty much anything other than a wet noodle hurts.
In my experience, yes.
Okay, I'm just wondering.
Fuck.
And I got to start taking those slap shots that I do with 8 Mile
Bike. Oh,
yes. Oh, man.
Eazy, I'll let you get the slap shot in this week. You good with that?
Oh, man.
Art slapped me last Friday.
I wouldn't feel comfortable slapping you, honestly, man. I wouldn't.
That's what makes it great.
I'm have someone just take my hand and do it for me.
That's pussy, bro.
I can't. It's my fucking boss too.
Right,
it makes it even worse.
Listen, so you don't have to freaking slap him.
Yeah,
you can just.
Yeah, how did you rate Art's slap, by the way? Because it was definitely a soft ass slap. Like, were you happy with that? Or you want it harder?
Listen, it's for you.
Hard enough.
It's for you to deliver, right? You just want to make a nice sound. Like, I mean, it's just, hey, like, to make him earn the drink.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I need a drink. I just got, you know, slapped. So wait.
But I'm not a China doll, man. You can put a little bit of force.
Wait till I do it.
It needs to be all fingers, no palm.
Okay, I feel more comfortable with that.
I'll take any slap all fingers.
Yes.
It's when the palm gets involved that it gets messy.
Yeah, you didn't say punch you in the face.
This is why I don't feel comfortable slapping, because it's like stubbing your toe or getting, you know, smacked. You ever get that, like, you know what I'm saying? And I slap is that for me. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I don't feel comfortable slapping anybody. Or obviously you stub your toe. Because, you know, there's certain like pains where you're just like, motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Don't matter who it is.
Did you say pains or people?
I mean, people can be pains.
Yeah, both,
works,
right?
Yeah, works both ways.
Hey, Stick, wait till I want to do it. I'm going to shoot it at you to make it a real slap shot.
Oh, God, that would suck.
Well, you're the originator of the idea, really. Like, we were just kind of talking about it. Then 8 Mile Vodka came around. We were like, hey, we got an idea where, you know, people can slap Stick and they'll do a shot. And it was like, all right. We're like, D-Mac will do it.
Well, let's do this then. We should do a social media post. That's what we'll do this if you want, if you're down. We'll do a slap shot as a social media post. Announce that. I'll get hit with the chair of the 10K. I'll smack you with the fingers. And then I'll do it. It'll be done. Everything's delivered, right?
Awesome.
You know my rules. Fucking present it. Tell me what it is. Show me the path. Show me the game plan. Let's do it. Get it out there. And then facilitate the masses. You never know.
1,000%. You can catch both myself and D-Mac weekly, daily, from 3 to 5, live at Woodward Sports Network on The Hook. I will put links to everything from the wrestling podcast, Grind Time, Stick does a morning show. We'll links to that. I mean, same thing, Woodward Sports.
The Wood. Get your morning wood on.
Morning wood on.
Stick and Joey.
All right, guys. Thank you. We out.